Okay, let's go ahead and bring in Peter Steinbrueck. How are you?
Yay, I'm good, thanks. You guys got a really engaging show, I have to say. And I like that raw, transparent, and objective. I would add also to it in depth. There's more coverage here that is meaningful than you often hear in these little soundbite, you know, coverage, so-called, you know, news coverage. So thank you for all that you're doing here.
Well, thank you. And we appreciate it. And yeah, you know, Converge viewers really like the longer format. And so they really want to hear people talk, hear their thoughts, hear their ideas. And that's why we brought you on here today.
So awesome. Yeah.
Yeah. So starting off, the floor is yours. You can tell our audience a little bit about yourself and what you have going on over there at the port.
Yeah, well, first of all, I grew up in Seattle Central District. I went to elementary school at Harrison Elementary, which later became Martin Luther King Early Child Care Center, and I forget what it is now. Same place that the current superintendent of Seattle Public Schools went, I think Brad Jones. Right. His mother was one of my elementary school teachers. She's a wonderful poet. So that was my early beginning. I'm a carpenter. People don't know that. I make bread and pizza. I love stir fry, spicy stir fry. I'm also an architect and Seattle Port Commissioner in my finishing up my first term. And I'm also up for re-election, I might add, for a second term.
Right. You're up for re-election in position 4. Right.
That's right. Thank you, Omari. And by the way, I've known your mom for many, many years.
Oh, okay. Well, she's watching live,
she's
man.
Awesome.
Yeah, she makes
Harriet
sure.
Harriet Walden.
Yeah, she always makes sure.
I was on the city council, you know, in 97 through 2007. And she was a regular elder advisor to all of us on, you know, issues of gun violence and police brutality.
Well, she's
over dearly.
She's an elder advisor to me every day. So, now, you've been down there in the port. You're wrapping up your first term down there in the port. Maybe you can tell us some of your accomplishments. It's a bit different. We've been talking to a lot of people aspiring to be in office.
Sure.
Somebody who is in office. So maybe you can tell us what you've been up to down there in the port. And also, what is the health of the port?
Yeah, of course, Omari. Thank you for that opening. And for me, the port's most important function is the jobs. These are primarily family wage, living wage union jobs that support so many thousands of people. And that is my central goal there, is to increase opportunities, particularly for underserved communities. And we're doing that in a lot of different ways, and keep that job engine going. It's a counterpoint to the affordable housing crisis and many other social woes that we have. That we have one area of, you know, where the middle class has not vanished. That's why I'm always trying to protect the industrial lands in Seattle, both Inner Bay and Duwamish, from gentrification, a different kind of gentrification. But we cannot lose that industrial base. That's my biggest, most important goal. I also am determined to make social change, and there are things I'd like to share with you, and increase equity and end systemic racism. Of course, that's a goal that many of us share, and it's determination more than ever now and needed more than ever. And then the port has been viewed as a longstanding historic polluter, but it's actually one of the cleanest, greenest ports in North America today. That doesn't mean we have more work to do. We certainly do. And so those are some of the top lines that I'm working on. And I have some specific programs I want to share with you if we have time today. But I served as port president last year in the most difficult economic and human suffering that we've seen in a century. And we weathered the storm. We're still working to get out of, you know, the slump that it has left many people unemployed and struggling. So we're working on economic recovery now through an equitable economic recovery strategy. as one of our initiatives. And again, I'd like to share more details of that.
Matt, we'll go ahead. The floor is yours.
First of all, I really appreciated your segment there on policing reform in the state. Now, people may think, the port, what do they have to do with policing? What do they have to do with policing reform? Well, we have a lot to do with it. We have 115 sworn police officers at the port. They're trained in the same manner and academies that most other police in Washington state are. They engage in mutual aid. They were called on last summer during the protests. And they work extensively in South King County with the various jurisdictions, Kent, Auburn, SeaTac, Des Moines, Burien. And they have a major role of ensuring public safety at SeaTac Airport, where we have 50 million people on normal years passing through our seaports. We're working to reduce human trafficking through an intentional campaign that was started a few years ago, focused at SeaTac Airport, which is a gateway for international human trafficking. So they have a lot of responsibility. So what did I do last year? All of us were shocked and stunned and horrified out of our seats and out of our wits last year with the terrible, tragic killing of George Floyd and so many other innocent folks. The long history of brutal and unjust killings, particularly by Blacks in the hands of police, is a pattern of systemic racism throughout our cities. I don't need to tell you that. I call it a time of racial awakening. Some say racial reckoning. I think the reckoning part has just begun. And it started with all the things that you just left mentioned with the state legislature. But last summer, I didn't wait for the legislature. I immediately called for an end to chokeholds and neck restraints immediately after the brutal acts were occurring. And then I led the commission task force, organizing a commission task force on policing and civil rights, the first ever of this undertaking in the port's history, to address these horrible injustices. And in the context of Black Lives Matter, clearly there's a call nationwide for extensive police reform. I'm not a big proponent of defunding the police, as some of your guest speakers said. I think we've got to approach it with more intentionality. I understand the reaction and the emotion behind that, but we're not going to do away with public safety and safety officers. We do need them. We just need them to do a better job, and we need to bring the practices that recognize the sanctity of life as the first commitment of all those who are entrusted with public safety and policing. That's number one. And de-escalation and these kinds of, and to be guardians, not warriors. So what do I do with this? We created this task force. The work is underway. It's quite a bit more extensive than what went on in the legislature. And we're identifying about 9 areas of focus in the assessment. They include diversity in recruitment and hiring, training and development, use of force, oversight, and accountability, of which I found there was very little of, racial equity, of course, and the protection of civil and human rights. We also engaged police union participation through Local 117. This is not the same as the Seattle Police Guild. I think that they're far more cooperative and interested and willing in working on police reforms. And also to look at the police budget, yes, of course, acquisition of military style equipment, that sort of thing, mutual aid, as I mentioned, and advocacy. So the goal to wrap up here on this one is to ensure that policing at the port is in alignment with the highest best practices, even developing the newest best practices, and lead by example. By embracing a thorough review of port police practices, protocols, and internal processes, and acting swiftly and meaningfully in identifying actions and reforms that we can adopt. We will get the final report out in July. It's been supported by internal staff, led by one of our port resource employee groups, Blacks in Government, and by our Office of Equity. And we also have a national consultant, 21CP, that worked under the Obama administration task force on 21st century policing. And then we have some external stakeholders who have knowledge and expertise in policing practices, civil rights protections. And we also have taken this out into the community in the form of outreach to help inform our approach and direction here. I'll stop there on that one.
Right. And let me jump in here, Commissioner Steinbrueck. And by the sounds of things, it looks like you're out in front, and you know the port is on a different track, and what you're saying, a more comprehensive track than what we see down there, even in Olympia. I wanted to kind of shift gears here.
Yeah.
You know, me, fortunate enough in my world's travels, been about 60 countries. I work with a lot of different companies overseas. One of them, I worked with Heineken for a while. You know, they use the port of Rotterdam. I lived in Dubai, which was a big port over there. The port of Mombasa, the port in Dar es Salaam, Tanzania. And I've seen firsthand how a port is such a key economic driver. I tell people all the time, some of the biggest wars and battles throughout mankind's history has been in control of ports and control of trade routes. Yeah. Now, you know, seeing in a developing country and even a super developed place like Rotterdam in the Netherlands and, of course, Dubai. But when you talk about Tanzania and Kenya, these developing countries, we see what a difference the port in a well-run port can make. I mean, it's almost overnight with import and export. My question for you, and I know you've just been there, you said that you're finishing up your first term, and you know, when we go back to the relationship of the Port of Seattle with the Black community, it's been contentious from day one. One of the things I talk about is taxpayer money went into the port, but Black people have, you know, time and again been excluded. One was just to be able to get access to the port, and two was jobs. And I mean, that's good if the port has jobs. Three, I think it's great that there's a focus now on equity and things like that, and people are trying to get a kiosk in the airport. But I want to flip the other side of the coin and talk about what is the port doing, or what can the port be doing, mm-hmm. to really bring these billions of dollars that actually transport through the port in import and export. How can the Black community benefit from that? Because to be honest with you, the Black community, at the end of the day, a lot of times we're just the last mile consumer for what comes through the port. And we're not actually harnessing the power of the port as an economic driver in our community.
I hear you, Omari. You're so right. Well, there are things we're doing, and I can be very specific about them, that are making a difference. And you're absolutely right. We have $3.7 billion over the next 5 years in construction works. We put a lot of money out into the community through our contracting and vendoring and procurement. So in 2018, one of the issues that I campaigned on was to increase diversity in contracting at the port. And I came from the city where we had similar challenges and a goal. So in the aftermath of I-200, which I believe firmly should be rescinded, and I don't know why the legislature can't do that yet. Let me give you an example. When I came to the commission, the participation of women, minority-owned business enterprise, disadvantaged firms was 5.3%. And we're talking participation in hundreds of millions of dollars spent every year in procurement and construction. So that has risen as a result of, in part, my efforts, a commission-led policy in 2018 that called for tripling the number of women minority business-owned firms, and also increasing to 15% the dollars spent in contracts. We have Mia Rice, who is the director of this program that was established by this commission policy directive. And I've known Mia since he was a little boy. I know his family well, and have great respect for them. So what we've done then is we've gone from 5.3% participation to 325, let me put it in real numbers, 118 firms participating when I came on. Now it's 325. And we have increased the spending. It's now $75.7 million in women, minority business owned contractors and vendors. There's more work to do. This is a long-term goal, but we've made this intentional commitment and we are putting every effort possible into it, working with our labor partners and our contractors and our vendors. So that's one area. I also want to talk about the Opportunity Youth Initiative, but I can stop at this point on that subject if there are any questions or comments.
I'll let Trey Holiday hop in here real quick.
Hey, Trey. Yeah,
thank you so much for your answers today, Peter. I think when I think about the port in general, you know, and what I kind of said to some of the candidates who are running for positions at the port when they came here to Converge and we talked about their platform. So much of it is that oftentimes, you know, folks kind of need to see someone that looks like them kind of driving these diversity campaigns so that they can really feel a part of it. And my question to you is, you know, what we've heard from a lot of people is that they're bringing their lived experience to the port to help with diversity efforts and to help kind of allow folks to understand that this port is their port too. Yeah. And so my question to you is, do you feel that the efforts you've been making, they sound very progressive, but maybe is it really penetrating the Black community? How are they understanding a lot of these opportunities and how is it being elevated so that those pipelines and pathways are clear so that they actually feel like, you know what, these initiatives are made for me?
Yeah, no, great question, Trey. And I, you know, I really encourage newcomers, young people, people of different diverse backgrounds to run for office. We need more people running for office. I'm not quite ready to retire yet, I'll say that, but I applaud the people running for office today. And the new faces that we're seeing and the energy and the passion and the desire for change. And I'm not about status quo. My determination is to bring positive change and relying on my past experience, knowledge, and insights. And, you know, I've worked with many diverse communities over the years and issues of race and systemic racism and injustices and inequities. And we're doing that at the port in a lot of ways. Last year, I also initiated a plan to make Juneteenth a paid port holiday. That's in recognition of Black Independence Day, something that people have been slow to learn about outside of the Black community. And that is a wonderful thing that we can now have a day of reflection that's a paid holiday. And it celebrates in a way the triumph of basic human rights, freedom over slavery and oppression of African Americans. So that's increasing awareness in a positive, symbolic way, but in a meaningful one, because this is a paid holiday. We were the first in the state of Washington to do that. And I had Ron Sims come on and talk about the importance and the historical significance at our Port Commission meeting when we adopted that.
Right.
So yeah, I hear you. Trey, you know, we need change, and it can come from many places. Sometimes it can come from from places you wouldn't think, and from people you wouldn't think are making those changes.
Right.
But I'm committed to that.
And if I could jump in here, Commissioner, we're getting short on time.
Yeah, sure.
I just know that it's like it would be good to see. And I mean, a lot of these things, what comes out of the port, I mean, it's positive to hear, because it's just getting people, hopefully, just on equal ground in jobs, equal ground in access, equal whatever. So we're behind. Sounds like people are trying to at least get on equal footing. What would be interesting is, like, you know, like in our community, I just really want the port to be intentional in just in education. Some things you won't learn if you never sat in the class. You know what I'm saying? I think that if all these boutiques here in Seattle that are independently buying stuff through middlemen and X, Y, and Z, if they realized that they could go and bulk buy and get a container over, you know what I'm saying, on a and land that container here in Seattle, and they cut out their middleman. You see what I'm saying? Like, these are the things. These are the economic drivers. If people because one thing is black business. Black businesses, we're the inroad. Can you know when we're purchasing a lot of our products, we're not sitting here thinking about how other people are thinking in other communities. Other communities are going and getting containers, and they'll land that container here in Seattle, and they'll do a bulk buy for a boutique or a hair care store, and then they're supplying directly to boutiques or hair care stores right here in Seattle, over to Spokane,
maybe throughout the region.
This is where our black community didn't sit in the class. And we didn't sit in the class because we've been so worried about just trying to get a job or trying not to be called out of our name at the port. And so this is good. Yeah. These steps are being made. But I would challenge you, the port commissioners, anybody running for office, is now how do we take it to the next level? And how do black people use the port like other communities do to create economic opportunities and economic drivers? We've got to cut you short right here.
Oh, no. I got my lesson from Robert Jeffries about building wealth in the black community. Black dollar days. Remember that?
Yeah.
Yeah. And I learned about that you can't have true justice without economic justice. And that means building wealth within the black community and other communities that have suffered indignities and injustices. So I want to just make one quick point. Opportunity Youth Initiative. We just committed $2 million for some summer youth training programs in communities with the highest unemployment rates that happen to be communities of color in South King County, South Seattle. Look it up. There will be hundreds of jobs available, job training in all of those areas I mentioned to you, aviation, maritime, construction jobs, and green jobs. A program that gets right to your point, Omari, about building opportunity directly through pipelines. And more to come, but we've got some great programs for, and we offer a summer internship at the port that is also available in addition to the Youth Initiative, which is focused on youth 16 to 24 in the most underserved areas of the county with the highest unemployment rates.
Right.
I hope you'll bring me on again.
No,
you should run for the Port Commission, Omari.
No, here's what I want to do. Everybody's worried about these city council forums and mayor forums, and I'll be honest with you. I know what a port can do for our community overnight.
I want to
do a port commissioner forum. See, everybody's sweeping on the port. They're worried about these people at city council. They're worried about for who's mayor. I'm worried about getting dollars directly in my community, and a port is a key way to do it. If we throw a forum, will you come on?
Absolutely. I would love that.
Okay.
Anytime.
We're going to let you go. Appreciate you joining us. Have a wonderful
day.
All right. Thank you. Bye-bye.